Crossover Championship. I'm your host, Nimsh, and I'm here with Raven and Lothar. We've seen some amazing things so far. We've seen Explorers League. We've seen Druid being dominating, and we've seen players being happy and sad at the same time. Unfortunately, both RDU and TICE are 0-2 at the moment. But before we talk about the players specifically, let's talk about the group stages, because some matches we haven't seen, and some matches are being played offstage. So let's talk about Group A to start with. We have AK Wonder, RDU, Super JJ, Boar Control, and we've seen AK Wonder win versus RDU here on stage.
And Ty, they will be playing another matches to decide who will be
coming
through. So for RDU, an
pretty
example,
good yourself.
In this situation, there's a chance that everyone
are you coming
else
to watching the match?
Will go for a 1-2, and I mean two other people will go for the 1-2.
Oh really?
Then there will be still some.
Oh, I didn't know. So you're like
back
in the late part of
or
the
of
day,
because some players people will start try to win later as much as possible. So
have
it will be a difficult
or
task.
Okay, so yeah, you're starting later than everyone.
And we also have Super JJ winning versus RDU. So as you mentioned, like RDU is in a really tough situation. There's maybe like 10% chance that he will actually advance, right?
I don't know the exact chance, but I would say it's more than 25. But it's possible. I mean, it's not impossible, but it's unlikely that it will happen. And the same situation, there'll be second player from G2 and the next group. And but yeah, but this group will not see any more matches until, I think, 9 p.m.
Oh, so they have to wait for a long time.
We'll have to wait and see how it goes, because the next match that we have it will be between Xixo and Trump, which is from Group C, if I recall correctly.
Yeah, that's right. But before we go to Group C, let's jump into Group B and what is happening there. So we've mentioned TICE, and TICE is losing badly. Two losses. He lost versus Kranich that we've seen, and Kranich lost himself to Legendaren. And then Vizhul was the one who actually won versus TICE as well.
Yeah, well, it doesn't look good for my players, but I still have some hopes for them. So maybe there will be maybe this situation will occur as we just discussed, that there will be a three-player tie and they will just play a rematch of some sort to just decide who will be advancing. But for now, we don't have a clear leader of any group.
Lothar. Let's focus on the winners, not losers.
Yeah, but
Vizhul, he won the UK qualifier, and he won versus European champion.
Yeah.
Not doing too bad at all.
Absolutely,
not
right?
Too bad at all. Got to be happy with the performance so far. And again, we saw in the video where he was like, I didn't really expect to get this far, and then to win in the final of the qualifier, then to get into top 16, and already now he's 1-0 up. I mean, he's got to be feeling on top of the world at the moment. Just got to keep going, really, and keep his focus.
Absolutely. But I agree with Lothar. There are no clear winners overall yet, because we've only seen a couple of matches. Let's jump to Group C then. Trump versus Sixo is the next match we're going to see right now on stream, and they are from that group specifically. Trump already won versus Ness, I believe, because Ness won versus Freaky. That's his win. Freaky's loss, and then Ness's loss is to Trump specifically.
So Trump might be the first person to actually have two wins in this tournament if he manages to win against Xixo. And to be honest, Trump is on a roll lately. He advanced to the second stage of Salado, to the finals, right?
Yeah.
He had a crushing results in the first group stage of Salado with 3-1, if I recall correctly, in a really stacked group with round-robin format too. So he's doing really well lately, and I wouldn't be surprised if he will stomp Xixo here.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Trump is on a roll like for the full year. Like, he almost qualified for the NA Championships. He won versus Farabat. He actually qualified for the NA Championships. He got knocked out at some point versus Jab. But he was really close to qualifying for BlizzCon himself. So yeah. Trump is an amazing player. And is he not top 10 at the Ghost of Games ranking right now in the world?
Yeah, probably. It's probably close, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So Trump is one of the most terrifying players here. But let's talk about Group D as well. So Group D, we have the last four players from our top 16. But not least, we have Life Coach, Colento, Slytha, and Riri. We've seen Slytha win versus Riri.
Yeah, and the next match after we'll have Xixo and Trump will be between Life Coach and Colento. So something we didn't see for a long time, the matchups of the Giants, we might say. Like, Colento wasn't really competing that much lately, and nor did his results were impressive, but he's still a force to be reckoned with. And Life Coach, well, he had amazing results this year. So we'll see how it goes between those two really great players after the match I will have right now.
Yeah, and Colento already won one game because he won versus Slytherin. So interesting times. We've seen a lot of great games, but we have tons of Hearthstone for you guys in the near future. So today we'll have, I believe, 6 more matches? Or something close to that?
I think so. It'll be around that amount.
It's 10 matches in general, and right now it's the 4th match, right?
5th.
I think
fifth. This is
then
the 5th.
We'll have
so 6 more matches.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay. And tomorrow we'll have Tobate. So today, round robin group stages, 4 group stages, as you've seen. Everybody playing versus everybody.
Oh my god, Trump and Sixer look very different.
Look at that.
There we
Trump
go.
And Sixer look like 2 Polish guys.
How did this happen? All right, guys, Trump versus Sixer, though. This is a really good match as well. So Trump, playing mostly in tournaments, he's not that known as the ladder performer. Like, he had his moments with Hunter before, but he's not the best ladder player. Where Sixer is the ladder god. He always gets the first spot. In tournaments, he sometimes gets really far, but then he didn't have that many wins.
Yeah, it feels a bit inconsistent. He either performs extremely well, or then surprisingly, he can just be like knocked out pretty quickly. So
he's very prone to emotions. Right?
Yeah,
that's his problem.
He's
especially if his opponent try to nail that weakness.
Yeah.
And try to make him like not feel well. With
and it's
the
something
game,
people
right?
should do. Like, yeah. if someone's going to get thrown off by something, you do it. If someone prefers playing more quickly, then you should just take your whole turn time every single turn.
Yeah, just slam.
It's part of the game. The psychology is actually part
slam
of the game.
Slam them. Just say, happy Feast of Wintervale at the very beginning of the game.
I wonder if Blizzard realized how sort of BM that emote actually sounds.
I mean, they had to make the instructions to make the sound voices, right? Yeah.
Just say it like say you're really like, not genuine about it.
Yeah, just say it like you mean it, but mean like you're rude.
So it looks
with
like
a mean voice.
It looks like it's going to be Aggro Shaman that we've seen very recently all pop up quite a lot, mainly due to those trogs having quite a big impact and making Ancestral Knowledge playable. And it's not a surprise that Sixer likes this deck. So as he is known, he can play other things, of course, but he is known more for an aggressive player overall.
Yep.
And
oh, wow,
from
that opening
another Curator, wow.
He just needs a dragon. Is there a dragon with Death Rattle? Yes, there is. There is. There's the Chilmo.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Imagine. Straight into Chilmo.
Chilmo can actually happen. But yeah, I'm super happy to see Shaman from both players, actually. They have Shaman in their lineups. And Sixer's playing the Elemental Destruction one. So this is not the super face. It is an aggressive one, obviously, with Leper Gnomes.
Interesting. So he plays the Elemental Destruction to just take advantage out of minions with Divine Shield, that would be my guess.
Well, Elemental Destruction works also if you just don't have a great opening. You can reset the board, and then with Lava Shock, you can actually get the Mana Crystals back. So I've seen Colento playing this version at Star Ladder, and he performed really well. So either you have a super bursty opening and you just win on turn 5-6, but if you struggle with the cards, if you have a lot of burst cards, you can actually keep them in hand, clear the board with Elemental Destruction or two, and then you still have like a lot of cards to follow up.
Yeah, it's something that the other lists of Aggro Shaman really struggle with. It's like once you lose board, there is zero way to get that back at all.
Well, you have Ancestral Knowledge, but it's definitely difficult to come back.
Spellpaw Totem, which will not that useful right now, but make a difference in the future if Trump is not able to clear it. So. Sixer's thinking about going face here instead of killing the zombie chow. Very interesting decision, just to be super aggressive instead. This might be indicating that he wants to use the Elemental Destruction after this turn, because Trump will try to maintain board control, so he'll play minions just to take advantage of it, right?
Well, actually, those minions, both minions contest the Tolem Golem, so it's not like you really have to kill the zombie chow. Because if you want to kill the Totem Golem with those minions, you still have to attack with both of them into Totem Golem. So the effect is more or less the same, but you dealt 3 damage. So it's something. Elemental Destruction is an option.
Oh.
Deathlord, Starlag, and Hunter Creeper. And Deathlord might be one of the biggest upsets in this matchup.
Yeah.
It is a great card versus this deck specifically because you're not running any big minions.
Yeah, and the Shaman also only normally runs one Earthshock. It's not too common to see two, and it might actually run none. So even just being able to Earthshot the Deathlord and just carry on through that is going to be rough, as the likelihood to draw into it this early isn't too high. It does have a lot of options, though, 6-0 now.
Yeah, it's a bit of a weird board, but what you probably want to do is play Doomhammer on turn 5 to start dealing even more damage and be able to contain this board. But then what do you really do if you don't want to overload? Elemental Destruction is an option, but it doesn't feel good this turn.
It feels too early.
Yeah.
I don't mind this. Get some minions on the board, and maybe the priest trades into them, and, you know, like just prolongs the game a little bit. But this Deathlord is going to cause some major issues. Yeah. Already we've seen Curator in the past couple of games we've seen it being played have a pretty big impact.
And it looks like what Trump will try to achieve here is to get as much value from the Deathlord as possible. So I wouldn't be surprised if he just slams it on the board, kills the Curator on the Leper Gnome or just the Divine Shield, and then trade with the Dark Cultist to maybe nail his Deathlord effect on the Deathlord, right? So it will be a 2/11 minion.
And do you really want to do that, though? Because
there's only one Earthshock, right?
Yeah, there is, but Deathlord is a great silence target anyway. So maybe you want to bump the toughness of the Northshire Cleric instead.
It's a tough one. I think if you buff the taunt up, though, he either has to just like plow through it, he has to draw Earthshock. If he Earthshocks it, well, you have a big minion that's still going to consistently trade every single turn, because he's not going to kill it if he doesn't have to, right?
This matchup is really tricky for Shaman overall, because in the very beginning of the game, you feel like you want to concede, because you're playing versus Priest. There are taunts, heals. But Shaman can gather so much damage with Doomhammers, Rogue Biters, and you can draw cards. There is Ancestral Knowledge for 6-0, so he will be able to draw something and actually accumulate a big hand.
Well, that's a big draw.
Yeah. That's just going to negate, with heal, it's just going to negate the 4 damage he did with Doomhammer this turn.
Yeah.
And something to bear in mind as well, although the Priest... Oh, wow.
Do you go Veilus?
Well, you know there's no Earthshock, right, in the opponent hand?
Yeah, he just would have Earthshocked. Why would he tank 4 damage?
Yeah, exactly.
But something to note as well, although the Priest isn't exactly going to try and rush the Shaman down, every time he attacks into this minion, it's 4 damage a turn onto the Shaman, and the Shaman runs no healing, so, you know, he's pushing you further into the winning position as well. It's kind of crazy.
So 6-0 needs Earthshock or Rock Biter.
Second Elemental Destruction. Wow.
Well, you might actually go for it, but then you will be locked.
I think you might have to.
I didn't see that coming, like, second Elemental Destruction?
Colento was playing two of them, yeah. So this might be Colento's list. I really like super similar. Luffy's list was more aggressive.
Oh. Is that the worst card in the deck?
You
to
do
pull out? The worst minion?
Possibly, because you really want to play it.
I think it is.
Yeah, because you need the... It's a 1-3, and that's it.
You basically need to play it. Like, you really want to have the shapeshift to go with the Doomhammer or just the steady shot?
The Hunter Hero power, yeah. Ooh. Okay.
I really like the decision to steal the Leper Gnome here, because just the fact that it negates two damage, even though if it might die to the attack from the Sin Finlay, doesn't really matter. So it's just like additional heal.
Yeah. Finlay doesn't do anything.
So how much does Trump want a dragon right about now with two Wimmer stages?
I mean, really that could
from Trump's point of view, with one Elemental Destruction gone, he might not know that there's a second one.
Yeah.
So that could just lock out the game from his side.
If only Valen Chosen would have added Taunt to the minion.
You just want overpowered cards, Lothar. You know, guys, that's what you want to say.
You know what's incredible? This game is far from over. Like, 6-0 still has a chance to win this.
Oh, 100%. I mean, the amount of damage you can burst into is insane. I think it's the burstiest deck in the game at the moment, right? With like, because all the burn spells are so cheap. Double Crackle, that's only 4 mana. Lava Burst, even Lava Shock to unlock unlock any extra crystals.
Yeah.
It'd be crazy.
Second Doomhammer with Rogue Biters.
Like, yeah.
If 6-0 has time to get those cards, he'll be in an amazing position.
And that's what the Elemental Destruction affords him as well.
Yeah, and he's going for it.
Replay the board, yeah.
Oh, double lows and the Elemental Destruction will make it very awkward for 6-0.
Oh, man.
He can clear the board.
Well,
he can clear,
I think he should go for the Earthshock here, probably.
Oh, Earthshock's pretty good.
Unless he will draw a second Doomhammer.
Well, he can take that.
Yes,
damage.
That was the second Doomhammer, so very good decision to...
Oh, wow. Look at the amount of mana crystals that are going to be locked. and he doesn't have Lava Shock.
He's taking tons of damage, but to be fair, he is facing a Priest. And this Cabal cannot steal the Trog.
Is this actually Light Bomb hero power?
This Trog is going to deal so much damage if there is no Light Bomb.
I think you have to Light Bomb, because well, he can't taunt, and the problem is, the Shaman's got a full hand. If he's holding Lava Shock, then he can Lava Shock and then open up with the rest of the damage, which will buff the Trog. This is the right play.
It. Light Bomb into Trog, it was just a free-free.
A correct decision, I agree with his line of thinking, because as you said, the Lava Shock would allow Xyxo to overload so heavily next turn that the Trog would be a force record to be reckoned with. And he still didn't draw the Dragon.
I was just going to say, has he like half and half this list for Control Priest and Dragon Priest, but forgot the Dragons?
No idea. That was Lava Shock, a turn
to
late.
Oh man, that would be so huge last turn, but still.
This is still good because he can Doomhammer, Feral Spirit. Which is a lot of overload, and then next turn he can Lava Shock and then play Lava Burst and Crackle as well.
If he gets something like, well, there is the Holy Nova, but if he picks up that Rock Biter, that was a really good decision.
Yeah. there we go. Oh, and he's out of Elemental Destruction.
A dragon? There are dragons in this deck?
I guess you might want to keep it still in your hand, right?
I think you have
to. I'm not sure what he plays in the deck, but if he plays a Chillmo, and I would guess he is playing a Chillmo, he would like to have that Death Rattle effect on board, right?
Yeah. And what's a 2-1 actually going to do on this board state? It's not going to really make an impact into the game anyway, so it's worth much more keeping it as a Dragon Battery.
Second Lava Burst, that's a lot of damage. He's just missing the Rock Biter weapon somewhere in the deck. And it's very interesting that he already drew 2 Ancestral Knowledge, so he'll be top decking a single card every single turn, so he knows what kind of burst he can do.
Yeah.
If he can count that, let's say, next turn will be Rock Biter, right? So then he knows that he will dish out 10 damage next turn, so what he wants to do is go through the taunts this turn to just ensure that the Rock Biter can deal phase damage next turn.
Might actually,
that's the way to win the game.
He can Earthshock. He can Earthshock 1, Abusive Sergeant the 2-3 to kill the 2-4 that's taunting.
I don't think you need to use Earthshock. You can probably just use Abusive Kill 1 and kill the second with the weapon strikes and then go 1 to face.
Just wondering, you're going to take 4 if you use the weapon.
Yeah, the problem is he's pretty low, yeah.
Yeah, if he was higher then of course.
What's a priest? What can priest even do to you? Like you've seen that as chosen.
Man. holy fire.
I just wonder if you Lava Burst face or do you Lava Burst the 4-5? Oh, he's using the Crackle instead.
And then...
Oh my god, 6 damage from the Crackle.
That's shock onto the taunt, extra 4 damage, this is nice.
So he has... How much damage? It's 4 plus...
That's 12 six. Damage next turn, 50. That's 16 damage.
16 damage. 16 damage!
He's dead.
Yeah, he's just dead.
Sometimes, Shaman kills.
This deck is so insane, and double elemental... Destruction helped Xyxo to reach this point. It gave him time. So he has 1 overkill. This is just crazy. Overload doesn't matter.
Roll the totem.
Lava Shock, Lava Burst, and Trump is concerned. That's so much damage coming in his way. That's Shaman, guys.
Well, the amount of damage was just too damn high for Trump. And, I mean, double Doomhammer, when you think about it, this priest got hit how much times? 14 times from a weapon.
That's crazy. Can we honestly say that Shaman is back? And I jokingly said that with Sir Finley Murgleton, Shaman will be playable because we can use a different hero power finally.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that was like a common thing when we saw the one mana legendary. There's only one class that benefits the most from it, and it's Shaman. I think the second class is actually Druid.
Yeah, because Druid's very like middle ground hero power, right? Yeah. It doesn't really do too much either way. It's sort of half defense, half offense. It's nice, but when you look at the other hero powers, because whenever you play a game like this, you want to go all one way or all the other. You know, you don't want to sort of half commit to anything. It works the same with the hero powers as well.
All right, so Trump is actually queuing Reno Lock this time. So instead of going for a mirror match, which I suppose he is playing something like an aggro shaman as well. We don't know which shaman is he playing exactly, but it's always better to go into anti-aggro deck than just a coin flip mirror match.
And the idea is if he draws Reno, he should win. Like
you say that, But
well, unless you get like YOLO burst down by turn six, then like if you have Reno in time to like drop it on that turn,
yeah,
you should be in such a strong position, because it's not like, I mean, slightly different than last game, but the way the Shaymin would want to be played is just hyper aggro, go, go, go.
There is,
so if it doesn't, like, if he doesn't quite kill him by turn six, he drops Reno down, it's going to be really difficult to
come back.
There
is a really good comeback for Reno. It's called Doomhammer with double Rogue Biter.
Yeah, true, true. Demon Wrath is actually going to be a really nice pickup that he's got in his opening hand there. Just to be able to, a lot of the, even totems, it just wipes any totems that are on the board, and they're some of the lower health minions.
So would you take the Dragon Egg because you have Demon Wrath, or just go for the PO? But the fact that the Totem Golem is the biggest minion in your opponent's deck?
Yeah, I'm surprised the Jouster could have been okay. What high cost minions are there in Shaymin?
But the problem is you want to kill that minion, the SAP, right?
That's
Otherwise it just deals damage to you, and you don't want that. You really don't
Fine,
want that.
Fine, just draw Reno, it's okay.
Yeah, and he has a curve as well. Like, if there's any other minion being played, he can Demon Wrath if he wants to, but he can tap, so... Yeah, I like Mind Control Tech as well. Like, normally this Shaman doesn't have that many minions on board. After Throw of Spirit, it's possible, but most of the minions are high threats. Oh, there's Sir Finley Murgleton!
Well, it's an awkward turn. Because even if you use Lava Shock, you still have 2 mana. So I guess Sir Finley is just the best option here. Now let's look if there will be Life Tap or here. Oh, there's both! Life Tap and Steady Shot.
Yep. You guys on the stream, there's also a rogue hero power that I don't think you can see. I can see it.
Sorry, guys, you can't see that, but yeah.
I think you always take... You want the biggest damage cards, so...
This version of Shaman relies less on card draw.
Yeah.
Just because you have those elemental destructions.
Yeah, Ancestral Knowledge as well, so you can always draw some cards from that. But yeah, like I think the best one is either Steady Shot or Shapeshift. I really like Shapeshift with Doomhammer.
So we're gonna see the trade.
Trump had the option to go for the Defend of Argus to clear the board anyway, but he knows that then he's not playing around Elemental Destruction. I really like that.
And this is the sort of the difference between Last Hero Standing and Conquest. The knowledge of the deck actually counts if you lose.
Yep.
And knowing that those cards are there, like, in Conquest, well, it just wouldn't matter to him because, he's won, he doesn't have to play that deck again, but this is huge. And it's going to be really, really helpful to play around, like, swingy cards like Elemental Destruction.
Elemental Destruction is so cool. Like, when Blizzard released the card, everybody was like, we don't need this, we had Lightning Storm. We're fine.
No, I feel like people will actually using it... As
Malagos?
A really good card for Malagos decks, yeah. And I think that was the benchmark of how good the card is. And actually, it's a really good card, but it needs a certain deck type.
Yeah.
And I wasn't aware of the Colento version. I usually don't watch Colento, so I'm really surprised that it made it to the list. But it looks brilliant. It really looks brilliant in this deck. I have to get it. Have to say that it makes so much sense when you think about it.
Yeah. And it's kind of funny as well, because the flip side is Lava Shock negates the negative impact of the Elemental Destruction. But I think Shaman as a whole needed something to actually make Overload good as well.
Yeah.
So then, like, when both sides of it have happened, you come up with a deck like this, and as we can see, some of the best players in the world are taking this deck to a tournament. So
bet Trog can survive the Elemental Destruction, right?
Yeah.
It would be +5
attack. Oh man,
that would be so OP. The Trog is good on itself, anyway.
Let's not make the Trog better. Again, Lothar after these overpowered cards. I'm glad you're not in the balance team for Hearthstone. It'd be like, should we get Velen's Chosen Taunt?
You know what would be the first thing I would change? Innervate.
What, really?
Yeah.
You would change it to give 3 mana instead of 2.
Yeah, of course. That would make plan to make it a Black Lotus.
Nice. Or just go full hog and just make it do Ancestral Communion. And innovate to 10 mana, go.
Yeah.
Well, meanwhile, Trump is doing pretty good, but then 6 much damage there.
This is what's scary about this Shaman deck. I mean, it might not be enough, I've not done the maths yet, but the fact that they don't need minions on board to actually finish the game out, the way it wants to go is the aggressive minions early game and then just burst them from hand late game.
Well, I think it's the first legit version of a burn deck, right?
Yeah.
Because it relies so much on spells instead of minions.
By the way, I think Trump has lethal if 6-0 disregards damage on board. Because if 6-0 just goes Feral Spirit, then Trump uses Hellfire and wins.
Yep.
And if he starts killing minions, how do you kill those minions? Like, it's awkward.
Well, he can play Feral Spirit, right?
Yeah, but then he just loses.
Oh, Hellfire will clear anyway, right, of course.
So do you try maybe using Crackle on one of those minions? If he uses that, that would be a pretty good call. But then risking that there is no Hellfire is also all right. So yeah, it seems that that's it. Just Hellfire, kill the minions, and then there is 9 more. So perfect kill for Trump. Unless there is spell damage, I haven't noticed, but there shouldn't be. Easy clear. And success is like, ah, he had it.
Yep. Well, you know, this shaman has to lose at some point, I guess.
Yeah, yeah, it was the Trug not being strong enough. That's what ruined the shaman.
He didn't get the perfect openings. Like, even with the elemental distractions, the opening wasn't that great, right?
Yeah, and what's kind of weird as well is, like, the Reno Lock didn't really do anything that Reno Lock does in that game. He just straight up just beat him with minions. There was nothing too crazy coming out there. There was no Reno. And I think there was just a Farseer for the heal, right?
Yeah. Just putting him a bit up. And Divinor Varga is always good versus those aggressive decks. All right, so right now it's 1-1. Shaman is out, and Priest is out.
Yeah, I'm going to see Warlock Mirror. And
this is also Reno Lock.
Yeah.
Like, every time I see Molten Giant, I'm like, Reno Lock.
Yeah, there are still a few players playing, like, Demon Lock, but when you combine it with Seam Bran as well, like, it's almost certain.
It's so hard to say, though. But yeah, Bran is an interesting card in Reno Lock. Some people haven't played it, but then if you look at the list, there are so many Battlecries as well. And it's just a good turn 3 card as a filler.
Yeah, and also you can actually just, because this the Reno Lock list by nature is so flexible in terms of it's all one of, so taking one card out and swapping it isn't really going to impact the deck too heavily. You could even, if you wanted, just tailor in a couple more Battlecry cards if you're playing Bran to then just get a little bit more impact out of that. That Ooze just going to come down for turn 2, put something on the board.
So what's important in this matchup if you have two decks that have an extreme ability to heal?
It's just not all going to be about board control. Maybe, you know, you can take the version of whoever plays Reno first loses. But if you can build a big board, you get to the point where Reno, although yes, it'll heal them back up, the turn after, you've like reset to like, you've gone back in time almost, burst back down the health, hopefully got rid of Reno, and then can carry on as the game was going anyway.
All right, so it seems that right now Trump has a pretty good situation where he will have Defender of Argus and he has some kind of a board. He can deal with the Shredder and what comes out of Shredder without losing that many minions. Or is there anything else that you can do here? I like Defender. I mean, just attack the Defender, attack with the Imgang boss into Shredder.
Well, the Defender changes the Imgang boss into Violet Teacher, so it's a good thing, I would say.
Yeah,
pretty reasonable.
Violet Teacher is one of the best counters to Violet Shredder, so why wouldn't you use that? And even if you hit a 2-2 or a 2-3 minion, you can then trade with the Ooze.
Oh! Oh, Owl though. Owl in 6.
Would you use an Owl for that? Because it's so valuable against the random legendaries that you players with Reno Jackson will play, right?
I just think like Owl onto the you can get so much value on the board immediately.
That's true.
And you have Coil as well.
He could just choose to taunt up if he wanted to, but just at the moment. Oh, okay, he's gone for the Argus, that's fine. He could have used some Fiorian tap if you wanted to, but yeah, the Argus is okay.
I just love this deck. So many random cards. Refreshment Vendor, Stalag. It's so cool to watch.
I mean, now all those people saying, why would you even make a card like a Refreshment Vendor? They have to shut up, right? Because it's
pipe down.
Yeah. Because this is why you have different cards with different type of effects, even though they have the same stats, because they can fit into different strategies, and Reno Jackson made them all viable.
Exactly. As every new set and new collection of cards is released, suddenly, you know, as we can see already just today, there's so many different deck types and so many different ways you can choose to just slot in the odd card here and there to make a change to the deck. Trade? Yeah, oh, he's going for Hellfire, okay.
Yeah, that's a pretty good Hellfire there.
That's a good option, I think.
His Ancient Watcher is just staying there. Dr. Boom as well for 6. So yeah,
Sylvanas into Boom never feels bad.
Yeah.
Tap into Refreshment Vendor, I think that's the option. Because you have an even trade with the with the engine watcher, which also, of course, feels very bad, but I don't think you have an option to do anything else here.
I agree. Starlag is not doing much. All right, so refreshment vendor getting the carrots. It's chicken. Was it chicken?
Yeah, I think so.
It is a chicken, but he says funnel cake. I have no
time for games. The carrots are the stable master card, I think, that throws
the carrots for stable master. I know because I used the card a few times lately.
Nice. In some ways, it's more of your crazy hunter decks. Yeah.
Now the Sylvanas is pretty much a huge annoyance.
How good would Mortal Coil be this turn?
Can you not just Stalag? I mean, you obviously kill the 5-3 with the 3-5, and you tap. And if you just play Stalag to contest Sylvanas...
That's not bad. Now let's think, what are the options? I think the reasonable option is just to implosion the Ancient Watcher, and that's it.
I like the Stalag play, because it forces the kill on the Stalag. And if Sixo does something to sacrifice his own Sylvanas to steal the Stalag, I was like, be my guest.
Yeah.
I'd rather deal with Stalag than Sylvanas.
But even now, like, I suppose you'd feel like the trade for the Sylvanas into the Stalag and then just drop boom like that.
Stalag is so awkward. Like, you can't silence it because it doesn't matter at all.
Yeah, you need to silence the second one that comes out.
Yeah, exactly,
out
exactly.
To be able to stop the death rattle effect going off.
Oh, Fuga, neutral.
Oh, the tap, okay. So I guess we're going to see Peddler into BGH. The options are Power Overwhelming, Bloodsail Corsair, and Voidwalker. What do you like in this? The Voidwalker feels like it doesn't do much.
Yo.
Yeah, the POs are going to be selected there. Pretty reasonable.
So he is actually stealing it.
Steal with the PO.
Yep. I mean, I don't blame him.
Yeah, hit for 9 and then steal the minion.
This is why I didn't like the Stalag play, you know? This is something that you
will lose. You're hoping it goes into the Sylvanas, the Force Tree.
Yeah. And now... Now he lost a lot of value.
Well, even you can Implosion and Demon Wrath. And it doesn't matter that Stalag dies, because you have Fugan.
Do they proc off each other, even though they're on the other side of the board?
Yeah, yeah.
Does the text say, like, if one dies,
if one dies,
yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, so that's still good for Trump.
Well, he probably preferred to have more imps, but it's still okay. It's so funny, like, how this game is slowly progressing. It seems like nobody's doing anything here. Especially with all those heals in hands as well.
I'm kind of surprised this many people have taken Reno Lock this tournament, to be honest. I know the deck's good, but there's still a lot of, you know, unsureness about whether how good it actually is.
Well, I'm sure the guys tested it.
Well, I think the main reason why would you bring the Reno Jackson is the fact that people play aggressive decks like Shaman.
Yeah, that's
and
true.
The Reno Jackson has, especially a version with the Refreshment Vendor, has a lot of way of healing himself because there's Healbot, there's a Refreshment Vendor, there's Farseer, there's Reno Jackson, of course. And
even Jiraxxus in some lists as well.
Yeah, Jiraxxus, and basically there's a lot of ways of preventing... Zephyr Soul, forgot about that. There's a lot of way of healing himself while still maintaining board control because you play some... pretty damn good minions alongside.
And also like triple to like 4 AoEs as well in the deck.
Yeah, Demon Wrath is awesome.
Yeah.
Demon Wrath basically does the same thing as Hellfire but doesn't damage its user.
Yeah.
And also it can go toe-to-toe with control decks as well, so it's really flexible.
It's a really solid deck, especially because of Starlag and Fugan, right? Like, you have Thaddeus, not a threat. So yeah, it's pretty cool. And a lot of people doubted deck. They said, like, yeah, this is kind of like gimmicky deck that's still worse than Handlock and Demonlock. But in the end, it is here. And a lot of people play it. If those guys play Reno Lock, I would say the deck is top tier.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, especially with Xixo, right? He always plays the top tier decks.
Yeah.
So...
Apart from the moment when they were playing in the ATLC and he brought the Unrefined Secret.
Unrefined Secret, the first version.
Yeah.
Well, he did sense the deck is actually good, but maybe the list was the best.
Oh, the Frostwolf Grunt comes out of the Shredder. I like just getting boomed down now. It felt like he could have got it down a turn earlier or so, depending on what he decided, but just getting it on the board is really important, especially when you're not really challenged.
I was thinking about the turn, just Siphon Soul it and Defender Vargas. But Trump decided to tap instead. So I guess he wants to clear the bombs with the 1-1s, right? You attack with the 2-2 first to the demon.
Yeah, yeah.
It doesn't matter either way.
It's basically the same, yeah.
Well, actually, does it? It's actually 50% now to hit it. I was actually almost sure that it was better to attack.
Oh, yeah, because you have more minions, right?
Yeah.
You'd have 3 minions when you start into the bombs. And
you guarantee one more attack before the bomb goes off, yeah. Right? So it was better to play to attack with the 2-2 first. If you plan, of course, to clear the board.
Yeah. But that, there's a bigger chance that the bomb will hit face. Not a minion.
Oh, that's true.
Oh, and it dies.
Yep.
It's good, though. Ah, 4 to face. But it doesn't matter, probably, with all those heals. He cleared the board!
That looks like a turn for Twilight Drake.
Would you want to bother following up with Lothab? Or would you want to wait till the board's built up to try and stop a Shadow Flame or something like that? A bit of a key turn?
I would definitely play the Lothab later on, just because, first of all, there's almost no difference between, an example, Harrison Jones and Lothab in this situation, right?
That's true.
And the fact is that if you have a Twilight Drake on board, you don't really care about the Shadow Flame.
Yeah.
Or a Twisting Nether, because you just have 2 minions on board. Why would you care about a removal? If someone uses Twisting Nether on that...
Great. Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
You're happy.
I'm fine with
that.
I have 9 different cards in my hand that still are being a threat to your deck.
That's what's fun about this mirror match. Both players have, like, massive hands all the time, so the decisions are actually quite intricate and not quite as straightforward as they seem a lot of the time.
It's kind of similar to Control Warrior versus Control Warrior. It's all about how will the game end and what cards they will have at the very end of the game, right?
Yeah. I would say it's similar to almost every arena.
Getting the most out of every
game. Like it's value,
let's play those Yetis, smash each other, and see whose Yeti will live at the end of the day.
So now both players have Reno. So they're even on that count.
They might play it for the stats.
Yeah. That tempo.
There is Bram Brosby as well. Can you double heal yourself with Reno?
Well, technically it happens, right? It doesn't change anything, but it happens. And both players like playing Twilight Drakes and then both players answering with Owl. Although 6-0 doesn't have the Mortal Coil to make it really nice.
That was the Jiraxxus. But when do you play Jiraxxus in this mirror match? When you probably want to play as soon as possible because it fuels your deck with permanent threats on board.
Yeah.
But the problem is then you diminish the value of your Reno Jackson and you can't go deeper into your deck as fast as your opponent.
But they're getting to the point where they might not want to go deep into the deck. They have Reno, they have some heal options on both sides, but 6-0 with the Jiraxxus, he might just want to lay it down now and say, I'm going to make 6-6s every turn.
Also,
you can Reno if you want, but I'm making 6-6s every single turn. Like, what you need to consistently clear this or kill me.
And is there actually some burst in the deck? Because if you don't have the board, how do you even burst? Like, you can get PO from Dark Peddler, you have Hellfire.
There are some lists that are running Faceless, Arcane Golem, and 1 Power Overwhelming. So they have the option for the burst, but I don't think these lists are running those. Obviously they might be, we've not seen all the cards yet, but there are some going around that have that burst option. And again, because they're just a one-off deck, it's easy to sort of slip that one in.
Yeah. Interesting. Siphon Soul, but you need to deal with Sylvanas somehow. So you want to run your minions into it, but then he's missing some damage here. Unless he uses Shadow Flame to deal with Sylvanas. Well, he has Dark Bomb as well, but it's just one. It's so awkward, right? It feels like a waste to use 3 cards to deal with the Sylvanas.
That's true.
Oh, man.
I guess you can...
Would you not just...
I think you should just use the Dark Bomb here and...
So I was going to say, would you not go for Jiraxxus, but that would involve tanking. A good chunk of damage.
He does have the heals.
Yeah, I mean, he has Healbot on Reno. You may as well, right? And again, you're not expecting burst, so...
What if someone just plays one random Doomguard?
If he gets over power overwhelming from Dark Peddler.
Oh, wow. You go for the play, right?
There's no reason for power overwhelming.
The odds on it drawing power
is insane. It's actually very good.
That's possibly one of the worst discovers from Peddler I've seen. Yeah. The Coil's always nice, but then Blood Imp and the Murloc.
The Billy.
Yeah, the Murloc nobody likes.
Amos likes it.
By the way, I was just thinking, would you play Rafam in Reno Jackson Warlock?
You can. Sure. That's Why a great not? Win condition.
Yeah, so much burst. It gives you your burst option,
You play
right?
Stalag and Fugin. Why not play Rafam?
Yeah, I mean, it's a win condition on its own. You don't need to draw anything else.
Play a minion, draw a win condition. It's insane.
I have to try that when I'm back home.
I'm playing that deck a lot when I'm back.
We'll do it tonight after this.
Yeah. I'm playing it right now. I'm queuing in line.
Do you like Belcher here just to soak up the damage, or do you not care?
I think
you can get a bit more value out of Reno, believe it. And I know he's at 14 health, but you're not expecting burst now. So.
I think you want to pressure, especially because you know Sixo will eventually take over the board with the Infernals.
Yep.
So you want to pressure him, and he can heal maximum up to 15. So the more damage you have on board, the better situation you have. And you're not threatened yourself yet. You will be threatened if there's like 2-3 Infernals.
Yeah, I'm working out whether he can go for an Infernal Shadow Flame, but it's going to be a little bit too much mana. Because then he could clear the board and have something empty for the next turn to then like Reno or Healbot and then Hero Power again and then Snowball from there. It's so whether he wants to risk.
Infernal Shadow Flame is what, 6?
And he'd be on 6, yeah.
What else does he want to do?
He'd be on 6 and be left. What could he? How much mana would he have left? 6. He would have 4. We could play the BGH or the Bran. Yeah, I like this. You leave an empty board, sit on 6.
Bran is probably fine.
You're not going to get double Hellfired for a start.
Double Hellfired? How is that even possible?
There can be a Dark
Bomb. Never mind.
There can be a Dark Bomb top deck. Have we seen Dark Bomb from Trump? We haven't.
Well, he plays one, that's for sure, right?
Yep. Tap Dark
Bomb. Is there any reason not to tap? Because worst case scenario, you just slam Reno.
But can you leave a Brand Bronzebeard? You can, right? There's no
Well, again,
deal.
Like double heal, but okay, you're at 15. Like,
What other cards might be devastating with double Battlecry?
Not really in this deck, I think. Dark Peddler
think
might
like
be annoying.
More bonuses, right? As opposed to anything that's too crazy, they're more like the bonuses. I say like the Healbot's the most impactful.
Dr. Boom, 4 bombs.
That's true.
Yeah, well, that's one of the cards, yes. That's true. Anything else?
I don't think so. They're not that
There's
many.
There's no Blackwing Corruptors there.
No Blackwing Corruptors.
Because you play like one dragon, so it's not certainly the best option to play.
Bran is like an additional card. It's not a key card.
Well, it's still a 3 mana, 2/4 minion. I mean, it's okay.
Good. And it works with like 6 cards at least in your deck.
Yeah. Right, when you play Bran and Defender of Argus, it's one of the best things.
Yeah,
suddenly becomes like a scary minion. Oh, he's going to go for the Emperor.
Yeah,
he was comfortable.
Well, now he will play Sunfield Protector, I think, alongside that. Oh, he's not. Wow. Okay, so he banks it on Shadow Flaming, the board, and then taunting up after that turn. Yep.
Blackwing Corruptor would be lethal.
What does he have now? He has 5, 6, 7, 8. He has 8 damage, and that's it, right?
Oh, man, just going to 1. No regrets.
14
Why not?
Health.
Twice!
Get to the chopper!
And we're going to start to see the power of getting that early Draxxus now, because suddenly there's 2 pretty threatening minions on the board. Draxxus still has the weapon to pump for another 3 damage. Woo. And there's not a lot Trump can do about this, actually.
Well, he has Shadow Flame.
Oh, for 3, so he could actually Dr. Boom Shadow Flame if he felt like it. I think, that's what it has to do to clear, right?
But then it's a really awkward starting from here because there always will be an Infernal on board.
Yeah.
And you have to do something about Infernals. So you will be slowly falling behind. Even though it's only 15 health that you need to go through.
Yeah, without running the actual any burst combos in the deck, then this is the issue. And this is why I really like Sixo getting that Draxxus down earlier.
So what about Dr. Boom and Sunfear Protector into...
You know, there's Mind Control Tech. There should be Mind Control Tech in the deck.
He doesn't have the whole deck yet. But...
Can he afford to just Reno?
Well, at this point, he probably has to.
Reno, he'll take 10, well, 13. But then he still has Healbot. Mm-hmm. So he does have the ability to like carry on and he'll survive the turn of burst. I quite like this.
That's all right, Minion on board as well.
I was thinking about Hellfiring first and then Renoing.
just to weaken up the board.
Oh, that's a good point, actually, because then Shadow Flame becomes a lot easier.
Yes, I mean, still there will be a 6-6 next turn.
But there won't be three big minions.
Yeah, and your opponent might actually trade with Union Jack.
Yeah, and the Hellfire does zero damage to you.
Yeah, exactly.
You might need it for this turn specifically. Because right now you'll be able to Hellfire, play something and Shadow Flame, clear the board. But it, again, it's so many resources.
Almost out of cards! There's Fugin.
We can get Thaddeus!
So do you Fugin, Shadow Flame, Malakar?
That's
but Fugin has Fugin four.
Oh,
four.
It's not yeah. Five. Oh, okay. I take it all back. Sorry guys.
Hellfire would make a difference here.
Yeah. Needs that abusive sergeant.
Are you can you just throw away?
Have you used one already?
I don't even know if it's in the deck. Do you run abusive in this deck?
I think you do when you play Bigam Hunter in such a deck.
What about just Hellfire and then Healbot Shadow Flame? You clear the board and you go up to full.
Yep. I think that's probably about as good as he's gonna get actually. And then next turn he can try and develop the Fugin. Because he can Fugin taunt. Next turn, if he wants to get the 11-11.
But Fugin taunt will not work when you know your opponent will still have the Game Hunter.
Yeah, I was just going to say, there's so many answers that could still be is in Sixo's deck to deal with any big minion.
Mortal Coil, one of the bombs. Oh, missed. I was actually serious. To Mortal Coil, one of the bombs right now.
It's so
to try and snipe
it's not terrible. It's not terrible, but then it draws you a card and you get closer to
Yeah, well, he will deal one damage to himself and be on the brink of fatiguing like one turn ahead, but wouldn't it be so bad if you will just deal the instant damage right now to maybe kill one of the threats?
The chances are pretty low, but I think it's a player.
Yeah.
Because you have 66% to hit one of the minions and 50% chance to kill one of those, right?
Yeah.
Is it not that horrible.
50%?
Yeah, it's 50%, because you need to hit three or four, right?
Yeah.
And that's it. Wait, isn't the Twisting Nether for Trump for the last card?
We haven't seen it, but this deck normally runs one.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many different variations that you can take just one card in, one card out. The Twisting Nether isn't too common.
Well, a bomb to the face is bad for Trump.
He needs the second bomb either go to the face 2 for 4 damage, or to the clear minion, and actually that's a huge deal.
It is. Yeah, he can actually clear the board.
Molten Giant.
So he doesn't have Twisting Nether.
Yeah.
Molten Giant is useless. And he needs to Shadow Flame this.
So, okay, so do you Fugin Shadow Flame, let him be GH, and then...
Then you will have to go for Draxus.
Yeah, but then you do have Healbot, so you can Draxus kill BGH Healbot. It's just whether you can keep up with, but then you've got the 6-6 to deal with, right?
But your opponent still has a full hand and a deck. There's like two cards left.
Yeah, I'm not saying he's in a great position, but if he did that, he clears the board, and then next turn, after the Draxus, he takes 6 damage. How much burst has he got? Because then he has the ability to play his 6-6 and Shadow Flame.
I wouldn't.
Just clear the board from him being behind.
I wouldn't actually blame him if he concedes here.
This is definitely rough.
Because you are facing a board that you have to deal with, and you are making a defensive move. So, I mean, this you can do, and hope there is no bigger hunter, no way to deal with Thaddeus. Thaddeus comes down, but after the bigger hunter, like, you have no tools.
BGH.
Wow, that minion, bro. 11-11 swole, dude, and it got killed.
By a dwarf.
Gets killed by a dwarf, yeah.
With a big gun.
Well, on it.
Such a party pooper, right? The big game hunter.
Well played from Trump.
Well played. That's how Draxus sounds. So,
good work.
All right. So Trump is
the voiceover for Draxus.
Well, Lothar did the voiceover.
Yeah, I can do the Polish voice.
Well played.
Insomnia Truce of the Champions. Actually, that's a very cool trophy when you look about around. Right?
But a very heavy trophy as well.
It's very heavy.
And it's not only like physically heavy, but it's also heavy mentally. This is the first global Insomnia, and we'll have the first global Insomnia champion.
Look at that. Trump is left with his aggro shaman playing Wolf Riders and Rajan Horse Riders.
And he got Finley. I haven't seen a version with Wolf Rider, but we can obviously say it's super. aggressive.
Yeah, there's a couple of flex slots in the deck as well, because where previously you saw Felreavers in the sort of mech aggro shaman, there's like most of the deck sort of slots back in, but the two Felreavers slots are very, you know, flexible. You can put whatever you want in. As long as it hits face, of course.
Most of the things hit face in this deck, at least. But I like how thinly Murgleton fits.
Yeah.
He's great in this deck.
And the 1-3 body's actually pretty cool.
Oh, man, and there's Shapeshift and Steady Shot. Which one do you take?
He does have Doomhammer, but I think Steady Shot's the better pick over time.
I think so, too.
Especially with his hand. Like, he has no turn 2 at the moment, so take the 2 damage now.
Especially versus a deck like Mino Lock, where you can expect some taunts, at least. Mr. Finley, with your shenanigans. He is a gentleman. He's giving.
He's wearing a monocle. How can you not like that guy?
The hero power gives such a huge advantage in this matchup.
But again, it's still going to be rough, because unless he can put together the big burst turn with the spells, you know, Reno's a card.
It is, but it has to be in the hand, and he has Doomhammer already. If he gets a Rock Biter, he might be in a good position. You have to draw that Reno.
Well, it's kind of easy when you have a Harrison Jones on a Doomhammer.
That's very true.
But if you have more than 4 cards in your hand and you will burn Reno Jackson.
Imagine. Oh, my God.
Feels bad.
The feels, man. The
would
feels.
You just concede?
Harrison Jones just getting rid of Reno Jackson makes sense as well. Because Harrison Jones was not invited to League of Explorers.
Yeah, that's
why wasn't he invited, Nimsh? I'm sure you know that.
I don't know, but like he's...
Oh, what?
Come on! No, we, guys, we've got a problem.
Probably was busy.
He's missing the law.
But his hat actually made it.
Yeah, for in a hunter deck.
Yeah, I love it with genies. Pick. I love with genies and Fain Death. The multi-hats. beauty to behold. Any overall has a value. If you played, if you play Explorer's hat on a golden minion, you get it back golden.
Oh, wow.
Oh, nice. Don't need to craft that, bad boy. Just have another golden minion and we'll be fine.
There is a Trog for Trump. A bit late, but maybe he can use it still.
He can Trog Lightning Bolt Hero Power. Seems okay. Would you Lightning Bolt the 2-2?
Just because they're Finley Lightning Bolt phase anyway. If you do that.
Oh, okay. He's going to do that way. Okay. Is he not going to Lightning Bolt?
No. Twisting Nether for Sixer. So Sixer plays the version of Twisting Nether. It's very interesting.
This is going to be so devastating, because this is the best moment to play Doomhammer and just go, I think, like, go for face, deal 4 damage.
Do you risk the burn?
You do not expect Harrison Jones. And with Harrison Jones, this is a really tough situation. Trump can still win this because he has a lot of burst. Especially a really great combination, Assist Knowledge and Lava Burst.
Now Xixo is going for the Doomhammer, and that is 6 cards. Will there be a Reno Jackson burn? Shadow Flame, Defender Vargas, Big Game Hunter.
What is getting burned?
Beard. Dark Peddler.
Oh, Dark Peddler.
There will be still one more burn. There will be still one more burn.
Oh,
but kind of...
He can't lock it in.
No. He can't play it, but it's still great pickup. If he gets Rock Biter, that's 10 points of damage just right there.
Well, there are a few options now. You can go for Lava Burst.
You go Ancestral Knowledge Bolt, Burst.
And then you'll have 4 Overload, for 3 Overload for next turn, so you'll have 4 mana. You can then Lava Shock into Doomhammer to deal 6, but your opponent will deal to you 5, 7, 10, 20 over those 2 turns. So if he has 5 damage during the upcoming 2 turns, you're dead. So you can't play that type of play. So the other options are, if you play Elemental Destruction, you fish for that, so you use Ancestral Knowledge, Hero Power, unless you... Wow, that's so deck dependent.
Are you dead in 3 turns? Like, this is 7, 10 damage you're taking, so that's not that much. I would go for Ancestral Knowledge and Lava Shock Shock.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind that.
And then Hero Power as well, because you unlocked mana. So you deal 4 damage
I like
to
that.
Face.
4 damage, draw 2 cards, help for next turn.
Goes for the really aggressive route, so both Lava Burst and Lightning Bolt.
The only... Yeah, this is okay. What does he actually need to draw then? Because he has to...
Oh my god!
Oh man!
That's how you do it in the Wild West.
Six-o, even giving a little smile there, going, yeah,
I mean, he will
that
win.
Just happened.
Harrison Jones.
I'm almost sure that he will win anyway.
Yeah. Because of Lothar, right?
Oh, man.
Seeing the life coach face there.
Harrison Jones got rid of Reno Jackson. What?
Oh.
Harrison Jones is like, we don't need you here. There's only place for one explorer with a hat.
And that's it.
8. Yeah.
Count the match. And this means that 6-0 is going to win this.
Didn't even need Reno in this matchup. Didn't even need it.
It was just faster. Was faster than his opponent.
So that was really interesting. And this means that 6-0 and Trump, they both have one win in the group. Because Trump won before. So they are both at... it was 6-0's first game, I feel. So he has one win. And Trump is at 1-1. He still has a good chance to go out of the group. So Trump fans, don't worry. Trump still has a great chance to get out of his group because he has at 1-1. 6-0 though, one win. So pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah, and a double Reno lock from both
that
these players.
That was amazing.
Really good to see. Really interesting. And there's always, I like the fact that because of the way the deck's built in terms of all the one-offs, there's a lot of different variations possible for each player. And we saw different ones there, the Twisting Nether versus the Lakov there, and even the Fugin Stalag, and we didn't see that on the other side.
I just love our players.
So
we told our players to shake hands, but we didn't tell them what to do afterwards.
So that was full instruction.
This is just a way of getting those awkward shots of the players for the future, right? So you can put it on Reddit and Otsutling or something like that. Like,
everyone's starting to make
the memes. I love those handshake from CSGO players. They like have no idea what to do. So maybe we'll get something like of Hearthstone like that. So that would be really, really cool. And I like how they are like in the dark. You can see them in the front of the trophy and like sitting there like, you know, can't really know whose that is. So
it's fine though.
It's real good.
I love this series. Both, as you mentioned, Reno Jackson decks, great. The mirror match was amazing. And then the shamans from both players. So we have new styles, new decks, and metagame changed. No more Patreon. Well, we do have Patreon, but they didn't bring it.
Yeah, it's really good to see overall, and good play from both guys. I think when you get like the Reno mirror especially, it's just like so intricate and so many things you have to sort of half play around. But because there's only one of, you can't really play around everything.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I love the Reno Jackson work. It's a beauty to behold, a beauty to cast, because you can't really predict what will be happening. Everyone brings something of their own flavor to the deck, and that's the beauty of card games. That's even though everyone has the same resources, there will be some differences between the players.
Yeah, especially where you can actually play a toolbox deck. So like some decks, when you, like let's say Paladin, there's not much wiggle room where you choose the cards. But with Reno Lock, having Twisting Nether, having Stalag and Fugin, having Jaraxxus actually makes a difference. And I think that Jaraxxus that 6-0 played early was a big win for him because he was the first to actually play the Infernals.
Yeah, it was really heads-up play because it feels bad to set yourself to 15 when you have so much full healing in your deck. But being able to just get ahead and generate 6/6s is the way you do it. And the deck's just going to run out of answers.
Absolutely. All right, guys, this is Insomnia True Silver Championship. We're here at Insomnia Festival. It's at 56 Insomnia. We have the guys here with all the computers and PCs having fun at the LAN event. But right now we are going to head into short break. So stay tuned for more Hearthstone after the break.